morning and welcome to our live safari right from the center of the African bush on this beautifully clear winter's morning, but we'll come back to that in a moment. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have dazzling Dave on camera with me, who is turning a delicate shade of blue. Oh, that's just the balaclava that he's wearing to try and protect his face from the biting cold. We are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. And forgive me because I actually can't really turn. I've got so many layers on. I feel a little bit like that marshmallow man in the Ghostbusters, or possibly the Michelin man. I'm not sure if the Michelin man is a cultural reference that extends past South Africa. And speaking of references that extend past South Africa, a happy July the 4th to all of the American viewers out there. I hope you have a wonderful day in store for you all. And we will be doing a special July the 4th sunset safari, where James and myself will be having some kind of competition. I'm not entirely sure what it will be. You'll have to stay tuned to find out. And we will also be doing a very special fireside chat in the normal style of fireside chat. Hope you're all excited about that. We're going to be doing lots of stuff on cubs, because even though we've spoken a lot about little baby animals, we've got so many of them and they've been so incredibly adorable that we just have to share them with you once again. And not only are we live, we're only barely alive at this point, we're also interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email them through to questions@wildearth.tv. It is 8 degrees this morning on this crisp and clear beautiful day, which means 48 in Fahrenheit for those of you that way inclined, and 281 degrees Kelvin for those of you who are that way inclined, perhaps the scientists out there. I thought that by saying 281 degrees I might feel a little bit warmer, but I definitely don't. Dave described it this morning when he saw what I was carrying. He said I was packing heat. So I'm actually packing heat, everybody, and what we mean by that is that I've got a very bright pink hot water bottle underneath my jacket. It's terribly warm. Siberia Zumi, on the subject of being cold and wrapped ups, Siberia Zumi says that they think that there is a squirrel sleeping on top of my head. Well, it is very cold. Siberia Zumi, you're not alone in that definition. James is very, very rude about my hat. He says I stole the pom-pom from the poor lion that he saw recently. I know the hat's ridiculous, but it is incredibly warm and cozy, and it provides a lovely neat spot for my microphone. Hold on, you'll hear it now. Oh, where's it gone? Oh, there it is. The only minor problem with this beanie, as lovely as it is, and thank you of course to Kirsty for it, is the fact that it is attempting at all times of the day to creep its way down to my left eyelid. But that's all right. We haven't quite there yet. I'll try and push it up a little bit. It's much better than the previous one that looked utterly ridiculous and attempted to bounce its way off my head. So there we go, the wardrobe woes of going out in the bright, fresh, cold morning. While Dave and I, in theory, go quickly off to the east, we're not going to be going terribly quickly because it's freezing. But while we make our way to the east, let us head over to the wonderful James so that he can say a bright and friendly good morning.
Good morning. Hello. It's very cold today. About 8 degrees centigrade, 47 degrees Fahrenheit. Wilm Doornbruck, who's filming us today, is dressed in a number of different colors, woolly colors. In fact, all woolly garments that he could find in his room he has placed upon his person, including a rather intimidating-looking maroon balaclava. Wilm, does that have a history?
A friend gave it to him. He gave me a superhero costume for my birthday.
I see.
And he was part of it.
Right, okay. There it is. Very nice. Good morning, everyone. You're most welcome on our little dawn jaunt this morning. We're heading sort of down towards where Karula was seen yesterday. That's our 12-year-old female leopard, provides the bulk of our viewing. Wonderful lady that she is, and her two cubs who are now just over 5 months old, George and Charlotte. To all of you in America, you are still in yesterday, but an early little happy 4th of July to you for later on today. And we, of course, will be playing our little game this afternoon in honor of the 4th of July. We won't probably be setting off too many fireworks, but hopefully the fireworks will be provided by the animals that we see this afternoon. I think that's all I have to tell you. My name's James, by the way, in case you didn't know. And please do talk to us. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. Let's see what happens along here. We also might be lucky to find those lions today. There are lots of vehicles out, and Herbert is also out tracking. So the lions we might see. A slightly odd... quite odd situation last night with a female lion trying to mate with another female lion and a male lion trying to mate with that female lion. We're not really sure how to explain it. The sort of blanket explanation for all of those sorts of situations is, it must be a dominance display. I don't know what the situation is. Very fascinating that we saw yesterday. And then likewise, we think that lioness has brought her cubs from Torchwood onto Juma, so we might be lucky there. Herbert is going to go and look around there and also help us try and track Karula and her youngsters. So, some good prospects for the morning. It always makes me a little nervous when there are prospects for the morning. So I'd almost rather come out with no prospects because then you're deeply surprised and overjoyed when you do bump into something. It's the distressing feeling of expectation that creates disappointment if you don't find things. But it's going to be a beautiful day. Of that there is no question. Because while it is cold, a very large bird just flew out of the very large Torchwood tree, which you didn't see, and therefore I shall have to tell you about it. I think it looked like an African hawk eagle that was sitting in this tree here. In fact, there's one calling there. Hello, Shamsung. Good morning to you, and thank you for coming on the Dawn Safari with us, despite the temperature. Shamsung, you want to know when it's going to start warming up in the mornings. Shamsung, it's only those are hornbills that flew out. It's only going to warm up probably at the end of this month. And then it will remain coolish till the end of August, whereafter, I mean, summer arrives in a day, and then it will be hot forever. So probably end of the month it will start to get a bit warmer. And then we'll have the odd cold snap sort of during August and September, but largely it'll be hot in September. There are some hyena tracks around the place. That strident yelling call you can hear is the southern grey hornbill. Very sad. There is the sun, everybody, about to peep up over the horizon. That's pretty much northeast where you're looking now. The sun much more with you in the northern hemisphere than it is with us here in the south. And it was now slowly making its gentle migration to the south for our summer. But that's not for some time yet, don't worry. I'm just going to survey the surrounds with my powerful binoculars. See if I can see anything. You've got tired of the sun, have you?
It's not there yet.
It's not there yet. But it will be soon. So the only dawn chorus is coming from the strident yelling of the woodwind section provided by the hornbills. There's very little else, no doves calling. I guess they're sort of a more summer sound. one or two red and yellow-billed hornbills going. Which is always quite a nice sound. But otherwise, all is pretty sort of subdued. I'm just trying to see if we can hear something else. Listen out for the woodpecker. Bearded woodpecker going. Beautiful. Isn't that nice? I think it might be worth sitting here just a few minutes and wait for the sun to actually pop up. Liam, this is your favorite, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You love doing this. Liam is of the general opinion, everyone, that we should be looking for big cats. There it is, Liam. Do you see it? Marvellous. Well spotted, VM. Naturally, I didn't get it coming up because I couldn't focus on it, but it's okay.
You couldn't focus on the sun?
No. You know I'm a poor photographer, VM. You mustn't make fun of that. That's very pretty. The world bathed in a new day. Isn't it amazing that you can actually see it moving? I always find that quite astounding. Very nice. Peaceful. You can hear the orioles calling. Now you can hear the sound of a crested barbet. Like a little alarm. Also very sort of subdued, but expectant. Move on now, everybody. Let's just wait for the whole of the orb to come up. It's almost up here. Then we can go and look for big cats, I promise. Liam, is this hurting your soul?
I'm enjoying it. Just wish I could have zoomed in more.
And I think it's up. All right, everybody. I think we can probably successfully move on from here. Right. Now, Justin, you say you're going to celebrate the 4th of July tomorrow. Yes. What are the important celebrations here? We have a few, what we call public holidays, what they call in Britain bank holidays, and I think what you would just call holidays. We have a few of them here. I suppose the most important ones would be the 24th of April, I think it's the 24th of April, which is our sort of celebration of... It's very distressing to find. Hang on a second, Justin. Give me one second. Me and my leggy blanket. Some deeply irksome imbecile has dropped a can there. Justin, 24th of April is the day that we celebrate our, the dawn of the democratic era in South Africa. So that was in 1994 that we had our first democratic elections here in South Africa. So that's a very important day. And I think it's, I've actually forgotten what it's called. I think it's called Freedom Day, if I'm not mistaken. Then we have the 24th of September, which is called Heritage Day, and that's where we celebrate our multicultural country. So, I mean, you know that we're made up of 11 official languages and various dialects within those languages, and I mean, in the number of population groups who not necessarily whose ancestors don't come from here. So there are a lot more Congolese and Zimbabweans that live here, or originally Congolese and Zimbabwean. My heritage is Scottish. Wim's heritage is Afrikaner, and so you'd celebrate that on the 24th of September. Then what else do we? We've got lots of them. I guess another one would be the 16th of December, which I think is known as the Day of Reconciliation. That's right. Yeah, those are the most important ones. There's also the 16th, you know what, one of the most important ones is probably the 16th of June, which is Youth Day. That's the one we've just finished. And Youth Day, of course, is the day that we celebrate the protesting students from 1976. And it was then that the sort of seeds, I guess, of the death of apartheid were sown. So that's an important day for us. Right, let's head across to Jamie. I think she's on Cheetah Plains. Let's find out what she's found there.
Oh, your update is that we've nearly made it to Cheetah Plains. Slightly slower journey than we might otherwise have done, just in case we both die of hypothermia somewhere along the way. But there we go. Perfect timing. We have arrived at the Cheetah Plains Lodge sign. We will be heading along the driveway shortly. Here you go. Cheetah Plains. That way. I'm going to go that way. Now Dave looks as though he's about to commit some kind of bank robbery. But a bank robbery in sort of maybe in the Arctic somewhere. Which is very different from Dave's standard look, because Dave generally on your average day looks as though he might be at home along the sort of cafes of Cape Town, possibly carrying a surfboard. Can you surf, Dave?
I can try.
You could try. You have to learn to surf, Dave. Anybody with long curly hair like you has to learn to surf. Oh, I think the cold's affected my brain. I feel for the cameraman too, Sally, watching in Oregon. Now, I know that all of you, of course, are... Oh, not all of you. A lot of you come from places where the temperature drops very much below what we are experiencing now. Just sit in the back of an open vehicle, as Dave does, and feel the full effect of the wind chill factor, which probably drops the temperature at least 5 degrees, maybe even up to 10, depending on how fast we're going. And it's more difficult, you know, at least all I've really got to do, so it's pretty standard, I move a steering wheel and I move a gear stick. Dave's got all the little fiddly things on the camera that he's got to somehow manage with frozen fingers. So Sally, in Oregon, I completely agree with you. They are very brave and intrepid men, our cameramen, surviving the extremes of the climate out here. Definitely a chilly prospect. And I've just encountered several American guests on our way to Cheetah Plains, and a couple of European guests as well. And they all have their blankets right up to their chins, and they look absolutely positively freezing. Healthy, healthy, brisk, cold air. It's so cold, we have an expression in South Africa, it's so cold that the farmers in the Lowveld are wearing 2 pairs of shorts. You could apply that same theory to James. Definitely feel as though someone should buy that man a pair of long trousers. He just refused to wear them though. He likes his shorts. He does have a leg blankie though. Okay, we'll stop talking about how cold it is, I promise. I'm just going to try and find every high spot that I can while we're on Cheetah Plains. How do you feel about things, Drongo? Oh. Fair enough, I guess. That's how the Drongo feels about things. Oh, you got him. Well done. Dave with his eagle eyes. Our cameramen do have them. All the birds have been so vocal this morning. The nightjars were chirping away. For those of you watching the the Juma Dam camera. You might have heard them. The drongo is looking very puffed up. Sort of double the size it might usually look. Not sure what's got them all so excited, but the birds are definitely most, as James described it, most vociferous in this bright early morning. I think it's because the wind has stopped. I think they're just happy they don't have to try and battle that particular aspect of the weather. Basking in the sunlight, as we will shortly be doing. We will have to, in a few moments, we will have to go through the dip close to the Cheetah Plains Lodge, which means we will lose you, but you can accompany us until we get to that particular area. So that, for new viewers, is a fork-tailed drongo, and it is one of the first ones that you will add to your budding bird list. And what we always encourage our viewers to do is to keep a list of the different birds. It, of course, doesn't have to be birds. It can be mammals, amphibians, although I'll be mighty impressed with you if you manage to spot an amphibian in the middle of winter. But amphibians, reptiles, insects, if you are keen on that sort of thing. If you're budding entomologists. But definitely the bird list is something that we aim to help viewers build up in the time that they watch our live safaris, because there are so many wonderful birds out here. So while we do sort of navigate the signal black hole that is right outside Cheetah Plains Lodge, let's go back over to James and see how his search for the royal family is going.
Good morning again, everyone. I have not found the royal family yet, but I am searching very fervently along this road where you can see the sun has turned from l'orange to yellow. It's very, very pretty indeed, and it is warming my face. No tracks here. Now, I've come along here because I thought maybe Karula would cross to her favorite milkberry tree over there, but she was in this block. She was last left knocking about in there sometime yesterday evening. So we'll keep looking here to see if she crosses. Herbert is around there somewhere having a look as well. Hello, Texas Tweed. This is quite a common inquiry about black leopards, and I suppose it will become even more common as the Jungle Book makes its presence known. Texas Tweed, you want to know about black leopards and whether they occur in this area? In theory, they could. Now, a black leopard is the same as a normal leopard. It's just got an increased amount of melanin. So it's just got a different color skin that is more adaptive, or more adaptively useful, if you like, for forested or very shady areas. Now, in this area, of course, it's largely savanna woodland, and so the light is more dappled, and being a black leopard is not going to confer some kind of hunting advantage. So there are you hear rumors every so often of a black leopard being seen, but highly unlikely here. Up around the forested areas of the Highveld, or on the escarpment in the mountains, so just to the west of us, around the Leidenberg region, or Mashingshing as it's now called, you might find black leopards, and black leopards have certainly been seen around there, but not here, no. Up into North Africa, or not North Africa, up into the Central African regions in the Congo Basin, you'll find there a lot more forests, and so you'll find black leopards there. And then, of course, if you go off to a place like India, where the leopards live in largely forested areas, the chances of you seeing a black leopard are much higher than they would be over here. Nice one. Thank you, Texas Twee. What we're going to do is stop at the next junction and just have a little bit of a listen, see if we can hear anything. I have, of course, not been looking now to the right-hand side, but that's okay. Let's stop over here and just have a listen and see if we can hear maybe the crunching of bones or the alarm calling of impalas. Can hear a chinspot batis. tell you, it's so peaceful sitting here with the sun on one's face. You can also hear what's known as a brown-crowned chagra going. And that's its wings beating. And then it'll go. Not much else though. Okay, let's carry on. Then that's two sunrise shots you've done in a day.
That wasn't really a sunrise shot, that was a landscape shot.
A landscape shot, okay, well, well done. I think you are progressing. Then, of course, everybody, unless the giraffe happens to be in an inescapable position, will not put the camera onto giraffe. He finds them deeply boring. Why is that, Liam? Because they don't do much. Right, okay, fair enough.
Like a flat cat.
Like a flat cat. Okay, let's see what else we can find through here. Oh, you know what's quite interesting? I learned so much from Herbert yesterday. I did a walk yesterday afternoon, if you weren't watching. And we did it with Herbert. And Herbert is a wealth of local knowledge. Now you can go, you know, you can go to any number of books around here, any tree book that you find will tell you that local people or, you know, use trees for various things. And then you ask local people and they say, what are you talking about? We've never used it for that, or certainly nobody uses those sorts of trees for that particular medicinal purpose these days. So Herbert is a wealth of knowledge because he is within the culture that is still using so many of these trees in traditional ways for traditional medicine. Now, Viv and I have a particularly, we have a particularly worst tree, don't we, Viv? Known as?
Strychnos.
Strychnos, that's it. Strychnos madagascarensis. And were that to disappear from the earth, we don't both feel that the world would be a much poorer place for it. But Herbert tells me that this is an extremely important tree, and I just obviously now I can't find it, it's everywhere. But it's an extremely important tree for people who have birthmarks, and what they do is, I will find you a piece of this tree, I promise, it's not a particularly impressive tree. They take the roots, burn them up, crush that, and then mix it with a berry called a wild medlar. And then what you do is, if a child's got a particularly sort of disfiguring birthmark, you make incisions on the birthmark and you rub that ash and the berry juice into the birthmark, and apparently it will disappear. Whether or not it works or not, he swears blind it does. So I've no reason to doubt the veracity of the story. Naturally, I cannot find you a strychnos now, despite the fact that they occur in forests here that make the windy, impenetrable forest of Uganda look like a gentle savannah. Fear not, I will find one. Where? Well, I can't even see an elephant. How am I going to find a strychnos tree? No, there are a number of elephants. Well done, VM. Now you can film those. You don't have to film the sun anymore. And there's that elephant peacefully feeds. You might be able to hear the sound of the white-crested helmet shrike. A flock feeding through the woodland. She has got an impressively long left tusk. Not quite so impressively long right one. It's quite a big herd. Now she's talking to us there. She's just lifting her head, opening her ears and saying, now, what do you guys want? Why have you stopped there? Why have you not moved on? So she's just assessing us, deciding whether or not we're a threat. And she's by no means being aggressive at all. I wonder if this isn't that enormous herd. There do seem to be quite a few of them in the background there. I just recognize her tusks. And I wonder if she isn't the part of that herd with the cow that has that enormously long tusk on her left and nothing on the right. She seemed to be the matriarch of the herd. Now she's decided she's going to come and take a slightly closer look. If she decides she'd like to take a really close look, we'll probably just move off. There's a little youngster trying to suckle. This is wonderful. I always think it must be so difficult to... human babies, they're picked up and they're nursed and, burped, and it's all a great big palaver to try and feed a human child. An elephant must just walk with mum, and mum may or may not decide to stop, and then baby must grab a quick drink. She seems to be pretty relaxed. The rest of the herd is coming this way, so we're just going to wait here and see what she does. You'll probably hear my voice getting quieter as she gets closer. Don't want to create any kind of consternation. Look at the little one now smelling us, deciding. He's also deciding if we're a threat. He or she. Almost impossible to tell when they're that age. Oh, and there's an even smaller one coming through. That one is probably only about 4 feet tall and is, I would say, about 18 months old. And the little one that we saw suckling, that one that Liam's on now, that one's probably about two and a half. Well, maybe two. Interestingly, no tusks have erupted yet, so probably then a little cow. I think, if I'm not mistaken, the bull's tusks erupt when they're about 18 months old. This is fantastic. The whole herd is coming slowly, slowly towards us, bathed in the golden dawn light. Now the little one's just caught a whiff of us. Don't know if you saw that. She lifted her trunk, smelt towards us, and then lifted her head up and opened her ears because she caught a whiff either of Viam's aftershave or of the car, and it's sort of strong smells of oil and gasoline. Liam doesn't actually wear aftershave, he doesn't shave. Hello, Christopher. You're all away from the deserts of Arizona, and you say, do elephants sleep in herds or sleep alone? They don't sleep a great deal at all, Christopher, but this herd that you can see around us here of females and their youngsters, they will stay together just about permanently. They might split up every so often during the summer, but not during the winter. They will remain in this herd together. And sometimes they sleep, like the little ones will have to sleep probably a few hours, well, maybe up to 8 hours for a very small elephant. But elephants largely don't sleep a great deal. And I think you'll find that if they were to sleep more than maybe 3 or 4 hours in a 24-hour period, that would be quite a lot. But they don't split up to sleep, Christopher. They will sleep, especially with little ones like this, for security, in a big group. This is an absolutely incredible sighting. Look at that little thing throwing it. Throwing bits of wood on it. And the trunk is just not very useful at this stage for that elephant. You can see, just learning to pick things up. It takes a long time for the coordination to develop. I think what's quite interesting is that, you know, of all the animals out here, the elephants are probably the herbivores out here. The elephants have the slowest developmental time. They are dependent on their parents for the longest, much more than any of the other herbivores out here. And I think that's got a lot to do with their brain development. I think it's also got a lot to do with the fact that they, you know, it takes a while to coordinate that trunk. See them all just giving us a little bit of a look? I think they will probably eventually cross the road behind us. I'm not going to move the car now. I'm just going to stay here for a little while. Hello, Scott. Lovely to have you with us. And you say, does each herd get led by a matriarch? Yes, they do get led by a matriarch. Absolutely, Scott. It's one of the few matriarchal societies in the mammal world. The hyenas being the notable other one. I can't tell who the matriarch is of this particular herd. It might be this cow in front of us here. See how she's remaining sort of behind the rest of the herd to, I think, keep an eye on what our intentions are. But the matriarchal function here in the herd is very much one of mentoring and leading to, leading the rest of the herd to water and to grazing. It's got very little to do with sort of discipline and dominance. So in a hyena clan, for example, the matriarch is the most dominant hyena. She will monopolize feeding opportunities. She'll beat up the others quite strongly. Here come a whole lot more just wandering through here. Another cow and her calf. Whereas in an elephant herd, the role is very much that of mentor and that of helper, leading the other elephants to where it's good to eat and where it's good to drink. It's not a role of dominance. I'm thinking about moving, but the road is such an odd angle here. I will try and reposition slightly, everyone. I'll just see how this cow reacts. I don't want her to get upset with us. How's that, BMP? Is that better? That's right. So I've just swung us round 45 degrees. Nobody's giving any indication of being threatened or being upset with us, so we can just sit here and enjoy for now. She's talking. You see the one with her head up? She's just gone. She's made some kind of a sound, which has been indication to the others. I don't know what it means. I don't think anyone knows what it means. They know what it means. But it was definitely a case of she was looking at us, lifted her head, and made that sound either at us. Could have been a warning to us. Could have been a warning to the others saying, just watch out. Little one coming to see us now. Now you can see the tusks have just erupted there. So I'd say that's about a 2-year-old, maybe 2.5. Here comes this cow with the big tusks. She's coming past. She's enormous, you know, she really is big, about 4.5 tons. That's 4,500 kilograms, more than 10,000 pounds. And they all smell quite strongly of elephant. Betty, sleep. Along the lines of the question that Scott asked about the matriarchy of an elephant herd, you say, if two herds met together, would the matriarchs have competition? No, they wouldn't. You see, it's not a dominance thing. So they wouldn't feel, I don't know exactly what the sort of emotional interaction would be, but they're very much not in a position of dominance so much as of leadership. And that means that there's not some sort of challenge for leadership. And what happens is that at this time of the year especially, they do meet up. Lots of herds meet up together, and the matriarchs do interact with each other, and the youngsters love it. You can see when two herds that are not that familiar with each other meet up, the youngsters run towards each other, and they really seem to enjoy saying hi to some sort of new friends. And then they'll move around together a little bit, especially during the winter, when the when the water is very concentrated, and there's no competition at all. She's eating a jackalberry tree there, one that's been beaten up many times. You can see it's been broken a few times. And it's somehow managed to survive, as all these trees out here do. Now, if I was to guess, I would say that she was the matriarch of this herd. She's the one that's kind of staying between us and them. She's been watching us very carefully. She was in front of the herd, and she waited behind for the herd to cross the road. And she's kind of marshalling them, I think, telling them where's best next to go. And that, I think, everybody, is going to be our first elephant sighting for the day. Let's move along. I'll just keep you updated. You can see where that elephant's gone, and you saw where they came from. That's where Karula went in yesterday. She went wandering in there to hunt yesterday. Herbert is around here looking for the tracks. I haven't seen any tracks on the road, but I haven't been looking that carefully. Right, in the meantime, let's go across to Jamie, who's got something much smaller.
Actually really lucky in this stunning dappled morning light. So we've got a steenbok that is relatively comfortable with our presence, relaxed a little bit and feeding away. Young male, only just starting to get its horns. You can see them, tiny little tips of them growing up from the top of its head. And like all of the animals out here, looking a bit chilly, a bit fluffy, trying to stay warm, looking for patches of sunlight, nibbling away at the base of all of the grasses to get the maximum possible nutrition. There you go, look at the little horns. He's so cute. And steenbok, I think, are definitely high up there on my favourite in terms of antelope species. They always look very clean, that white and then tan contrast. Large eyes and large ears. And if you have a look at the shape of its back, the way that it arches up like that. It's one of the big differences between a steenbok and dacre. If you are unfamiliar with the different antelope of this area, they're both of a similar size. The steenbok is a much more red, or has a much more red tone to its fur. It's also got that arching back, slightly rounder than the straight back of a dacre. Now, our little friend was very comfortable with us, but if we try and reverse now to get another view, it's just going to run away, because then it becomes, it's basically reading our behavior, and then it becomes clear that we are focused on it. So it will just decide that actually discretion is much safer and will probably run away further into this very thick woodland. But there's parts of Cheetah Plains that are incredibly open. There's also parts of it that are relatively dense. And we're in the dense region, making our way south towards the Mala-Mala boundary to see what we can find there. And I think today we're on a cheetah search. That's the plan. We've done well with the big cats otherwise. Good morning to Bridge in London. You wanted to know a little bit about our different antelope species, and one in particular that we have yet to see on the live safari, but that we could actually encounter, and that is the sable antelope. A sable antelope we do get here. There's one that's very often seen on Nkoro. Sorry, Bridge, I'll get back to this in a moment. We appear to have a roadblock. I'm trying to work out how we're going to squeeze past this roadblock. Terribly inconveniently placed landscaping, Ellie's. I think we're going to have to squeeze through here, Dave. Oh, mind the VR rig. Okay, you ready for that to fling back towards you? Okay. Don't want to hurt you. There we go, well handled. Squeeze through. There we go. Magic. Right, so the sable antelope and its size difference in comparison to the other antelope, it's one of the biggest that we get out here. It falls under what's known as the horse antelope tribe. They are absolutely huge. They're probably about the size of a waterbuck would be a rough comparison, with those enormous, for the males at least, the enormous backwards curving horns. Females also have horns, but they are not quite as impressive as that of the male. Now, for the first time in 18 years, a couple of months ago, a sable was seen on the Juma Dam camera late at night. They're often seen around Nkoro, which is not too far away from where we are now, but it's still something we're going to get incredibly excited about if we see them. There probably will be much, much excitement amongst us and all of the viewers in that particular scenario. It's just because they're rare for us. We never ever get to see them. But we could, and I think that the drought is going to dramatically increase our chances of encountering one, since they're going to have limited access to water resources, and they'll have to start moving through to the various pumped water holes. Now, strangely enough, Bridge, Mala Mala is named after sable, and that's because at one stage, in its natural state, this area was not teeming with sable, but definitely had lots and lots of sable around it. And it's only with the man-made dams and the influx of other large animals, large herbivores, that sable have actually been pushed out a little bit. That's one of our rarest, definitely, I'd say one of the most beautiful of all of the antelope, with its glistening black coat, deep brown to the point of being black. Obviously, that's where the name sable comes from. Really, truly extraordinary looking antelope. And quite aggressive, strangely enough. I mean, not towards vehicles, obviously, but I've been charged twice by sable, once on horseback and once on foot. And it's quite a disconcerting experience, because you don't quite know. A lion charge, you know what to do. An elephant charge, you know what to do. But a sable charge is a bit more confusing. But luckily for me, my horse made up its mind for me. And off we went in the opposite direction. There was absolutely no controlling that. But these were captive bred sable. There's a lot of breeding programs for the rare antelope, and it's been one of the things that has saved antelope like the sable and the roan antelope, and kept their population at not a healthy number, but it has definitely improved things, because we were at the stage where it looked as though we were going to lose sable and roan from South Africa. Now, the interesting thing about where we are at the moment, we're on the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains. For those of you who are sending through questions, I may or may not hear them at this point. There's some crackly communication coming through from Final Control, and of course that's how we get your questions, as they get fed through our earpieces. So we can sort of hear. It sounded like James was doing something. I'm getting an update from Lou, but I have absolutely no idea what James is doing, so we'll keep on towards Cheetah Plains, or the plains of Cheetah Plains. Let's see if we can't find those cheetah. And while we carry on in that general direction, I was treated to probably one of the most extraordinary sightings I have ever seen in terms of lions mating yesterday. I've never encountered a situation where you have a female mating with a male, and then another female that has just had cubs, and that was the situation we had yesterday. And what was truly remarkable about that was the behavior exhibited by the mating female. So it was Amber Eyes from the Nkuhuma Pride. And the way that she did it, she mounted the other female, even going so far as to demonstrate, you know how that when the male mates with the female, he grabs the back of her neck? She was even doing that to the other female. And that is behavior that I have never encountered before. Now, you get a lot of what's known as mock mounting in nature, where an animal mounts another one, two male elephants, for example, or two male giraffe, and it's their way of demonstrating dominance. I don't think that's what was happening there, though. I think the hormones were confusing. I suppose you've got a lactating female with new cubs and then a female in estrus, and it just created a tremendously interesting situation. And we actually, in the end, found ourselves intervening in a way, not intentionally, but getting caught up in the love triangle between these three lions, the poor male looking terribly confused because the female would run away from him and then go and try and mate with the other female. And he just looked most perplexed at this situation. And what they ended up doing was the female and the male started playing, trying to get around us, because the female was trying to ditch the male, and they were using our vehicle to do it. So the female would walk around one side of the car, he would walk around the front and block her. Then she'd try and go the other way, and he'd walk around that side and block her. It was the most extraordinary sighting. I've never been involved in a sighting like that before. Oh look, we're not alone. How unusual. We have a question coming through from one of our viewers in Oklahoma, and please forgive me. I think you might be called Kim. Ken! Ken! Ken, you're not called Kim at all, you're called Ken. I'm sorry, Ken, in Oklahoma. Dave is helping me out here as well. You wondered, will the lions continue to mate throughout the night? Yes, absolutely, they will mate at night. Pretty much continuously. In summer, they actually probably do more mating at night than they do during the day because it's not nearly so hot. In winter, that's a slightly different situation, and they mate evenly throughout the day and throughout the night. That is, of course, unless Amber Eyes manage to, in the darkness, ditch the male and run off in search of her female companion. But lion mating continues about roughly. No, that's hyena. Sorry, I thought I saw wild dog tracks, but it's hyena tracks. That behavior will continue roughly once every 15 to 20 minutes, every hour, all day, every day, for five or so days. It's quite an exhausting process, the mating process. Ah, the beautiful open area of cheetah plains. Let me just try and see what's over there. Don't think... Oh. The vehicle that was accompanying us has disappeared. There is a shape there off in the distance. I'm just going to... Dave, I couldn't begin to describe where it is. I'm just going to try and look through my binoculars. Let me maybe check first, just in case it's something else. It's a tree. It's a tree. It is a tree. I wanted to make sure before Dave zoomed in that it wasn't one of our other animals that we do not show. But it's not. It's a tree. Marvelous. Okay, well, we found a tree on Cheetah Plains. It's a start. Let's try and find some actual animals now. This is where I would be. If I were an animal right now in midwinter, this is where I would be. Okay, another question from an anonymous asker. Not anonymous, of course, I just can't hear your name and I do apologize. I think it might have... Dee! Good morning, Dee. Why are our communications so crackly today? Anyway, Dee, you've asked a question that often fascinates me, and that's about the muscle tone of the bigger cats. Since they sleep so much, it's not like they're out training every morning like our human sports athletes. So how is it that they are able to maintain their level of fitness? and do the things that they do when they spend most of their time sleeping? Very good question. It's one I've asked before, and I asked it where I was dealing with a captive cheetah. It had been removed from a farm and put into a boma so that it got used to the area before being released into the wild. And I asked the vet at the time, surely this creature is going to become very unfit and not be able to hunt once it's released. And apparently their muscle tone is completely different to that of a human being. Their muscles are actually really floppy, believe it or not, when you touch them. And I've been fortunate enough to handle all of the big cats whilst they've been anaesthetized for various reasons. When you touch their muscles, you expect them to be like steel, rock hard like an athlete. It's not. It's soft and squishy. And that's because it's a different type of muscle tissue that doesn't lose condition. But then of course all of our big cats are not exactly marathon runners. They are sprinters. They have short bursts of energy that cannot be maintained for much longer than a couple of hundred meters. Some of the longest chases I've seen have probably been lions. They chased for up to a kilometer or 2 kilometers, a couple of miles. But they really generally, all of the big cats are explosive predators. They explode with that dash of burst of speed and then they stop. Which is why you'll see a lot of the time when we've seen lots and lots of attempted hunts. Most of the time they are aborted before they even start. So the animal immediately knows, obviously through practice, that this isn't going to work. We're not going to manage to be successful, so we're not going to waste the energy in doing it. But it is a fascinating thing that the animals are able to maintain that level of conditioning, considering they don't really train for it. They don't even stretch and warm up. Did you get that, Dave? No, me neither. Sorry, everybody. I think Bridge is asking, while we search for our cheetah in this open area, that's Bridge from the United Kingdom. I think Bridge is asking whether or not we've ever seen King Cheetah. I think that was it. Well, Bridge, I have seen a King Cheetah before. Hey, we got it right. This is we're basically going to do this in a slightly more complicated manner. Yes, so Bridge, I have seen a king cheetah. I have only ever seen a king cheetah in a breeding facility. It's one of those weird things. It's a naturally occurring genetic mutation, but it's very, very rare. It's kind of like the melanistic leopards that James was talking about earlier. But what human beings have done, because Cheetah in general are actually a species that are slowly working their way towards a natural extinction, but unfortunately that's been helped out by human beings through habitat loss and so on. So we've had the same impact on cheetahs we've had on all other animals. But a lot of the breeding centers seem to think that trying to breed up the number of king cheetah is the way forward. I'm not entirely sure. So a king cheetah has just got extra levels of melanin. It's got bigger spots, almost to the point of being stripes, much, much darker in color. I don't necessarily see that favoring that genetic line. I sort of feel as I do about white lion breeding. It's more for a human desire to see something different than it is about necessarily doing any good for the cheetah population itself. Hello, little Cokie Franklins. Aren't they so terribly pretty? Oh, the male's ducked behind a tree. Lovely example of the dimorphism. That's the female that Dave is showing you there. I think they're probably some of the prettiest Franklin that we get here. Really subtle colouring. And then the male with his bright orange head is playing hard to get. But I think he's about to come into view now. There he is. Actually, I think it might be quite a young one. Doesn't have that completely orange coloration that the males get at full when they're full grown. It's got a little funny tufts on the top of its head. Got a little white spot. Creak goes Rusty. Alrighty. While I try and figure out what on earth is going on with my radio communications, I believe that James would like to give you an update, so let's head across to Wendy and we'll catch up with you later.
Right, well, we found tracks of the Queen and a cub or two knocking about just over there, and we couldn't really tell where they went, so Vim and I went for a short walk. We headed off into the western block. We found one more track, but nothing else. We then came back to the road and we found the tracks heading this way, which is east. Anyway, we put Herbert onto the tracks, and he, of course, will be able to tell exactly where they've gone. So we'll just check around here for a bit, see what else we can find. We might be lucky. He also thought he heard some lions around the Twin Dams region. So we'll just check around here for a while, and then we'll go back towards Twin Dams, and maybe we'll be lucky with some lions. It is a glorious morning. It really is absolutely stunning, but it is crisply cold, and there's some strange clouds building in the west, which is leopard tracks on the left. And what do you suppose that is? I think Herbert may have lost a tire. A BF Goodrich 215. Brilliant. Thanks for that, Liam. Herbert, you copy Herbert? We better just tell him about that. Herbert, you lost a spare tire. He lega Treehouse Dam Road. So Herbert was around here, obviously, as evidenced by his spare tire, and he's walked up and down here. He followed the tracks down towards the south, and then he found a whole lot of impala, so he didn't think that they'd gone down there. Anyway, you know what these leopards are like. They're all over the place, and 9 times out of 10 we find them, well, simply by bumping them. The last time we did see them, though, Herbert did find them on foot, so it is a... You've got a highly skilled tracker like him. It really does make a difference. Ooh, there's some birds for him. I know you love filming birds in the morning. There's a fork-tailed drongo, and if you watch it carefully, try that one, Nervium. Beastly irritating birds moving around. Look at the lovely colours on that stunning starling. That's a Cape glossy starling or a greater blue-eared glossy starling. It's very difficult to tell unless it calls. Looking for insects and things. Now, if I heard your question correctly, Soraya and Dr. Rob, you want to know which organisms, if I'm right in saying this. In fact, I'm just going to ask Louise to read it again to me because it's quite a complex question, I think, and I don't want to get it wrong. Which organisms are the most well camouflaged and able to hide out here? Well, I mean, in terms of the mammals, definitely the leopards are exceptionally good at hiding from things. They are definitely the ones that seem to be able to hide more easily than anything else. But I think that you'll find there are many, many different kinds of insects that are far better able to hide. And to my mind, the mantids, those praying mantises that live on some of those Waltheria flowers and various other flowers, that they're, you know, they're kind of specifically evolved to live on one specific type of flower. And those, to me, would be the most cryptically coloured and most impossible to see. And that's that big tree there, Vimpy. Simply because I thought I saw some slightly discoloured piece of the tree. And indeed I did. It is a slightly discoloured piece of tree, but it is not a leopard that is discolouring the tree. We'll carry on. So far, everybody, only one big cat has been seen, and that was on Biffle's Hook, and it disappeared into a drainage line. That was a male leopard. We don't know who that was, which would be quite interesting. We haven't seen Tingana for a long time, and Viam is getting horrible withdrawal symptoms from seeing his friend. Viam, when are you going on leave?
Wednesday.
So you're going on leave on Wednesday, everybody, so hopefully we'll be able to see Tingana before then. Well, and Viam will be very sad. We'll just stop on the top of the dam wall here and have a listen, see what we can see, bathe ourselves in the sun slightly. We don't know where those lions have gone. Aubrey's trying to find the lions from last night. There are some waterbuck, Viam. They're a long way away. Let's keep going round. We won't stop here. We'll just keep going around the corner there. They're in there somewhere. They're just around here. Waterbuck in the morning. I still haven't found your strychnos tree, everybody, despite the fact that they grow in such thickets here. I will find one, I promise. They're cryptically coloured, obviously, this morning, hiding, because they know the disdain I hold for them. Right, here are the waterbuck. I'll be slightly disappointed to find that there is no water in Treehouse Dam, I'm sure. There we are. There we go. They've got just such a lovely fur. These chaps, I've always thought for a winter fur, if I was going to be an animal, a waterbuck has got the best. They just don't like being around us very much, do they, Viam?
No. Can't blame them.
Why not? Speak for yourself. There we are. They are really trying to get away from us. Those are the youngsters. Little ones. I always think they look like little donkeys when they're born. And the elephants that we saw earlier, you may have just heard that crack in the bush. And that was one of the branches breaking as the elephants we saw earlier are coming this way. They're heading towards the dam. They might do a little bit of excavating there. We do know that they dig quite well, especially when they can feel water flowing under the ground, and there seems to be water flowing under the ground at Treehouse Dam. But I don't think Karula's actually particularly close to where we are now. I just have that feeling. So we'll go off towards Twin Dams and see if we don't pick up on the lions that Herbert thought he heard calling around there earlier on. Twin Dams, of course, the coldest section of the reserve because it's the lowest section of the reserve. A very nice question from Kathy in Tennessee, and it's actually something I've been giving thought to myself. She says it's obvious when a male lion territory becomes taken over by another coalition, as it was with the Birminghams. The Matimbas ran away. There were farms further south of us, and the Birminghams were suddenly the flavour of the month. And Kathy, you're wondering how on earth you tell when a male leopard has lost his territory. Kathy, not with much ease. It's very difficult to tell if a male lion or male leopard's lost his territory. We didn't realize that Mvula had lost his territory until suddenly he wasn't found around here anymore, and he was found somewhere else. And that was over sort of a period of a few months or so. So Tingana's missing. Now, Tingana's in his prime. The only thing that's going to make Tingana lose his territory is if something kills him. And I don't think that's happened. It's not unusual that we shouldn't have seen him for this period. So I wouldn't worry about that. But what would happen is that suddenly you would start seeing other male leopards. So let's pretend, God forbid, that Tingana had been killed by something, maybe a lion or something like that. If he had been killed, listen to all these birds. It's these white-crested helmet shrikes coming towards us. There you can see one or two. That's lovely. And there's one sitting right out in the open there. Far left. Yeah, left? Yeah, you got him. Well, there's a chagra. I think, what is that? No, it's one of the white-crested helmet shrikes. Brilliant stuff. So, Kathy, you would eventually then just start seeing other male leopards where you used to see Tingana. And those other male leopards would be calling, they'd make a noise, and you know, that's how you'd know. But it wouldn't be obvious like it is. You're absolutely right, when a lion tells you to take over, it happens. And I also think that it's quite possible that there could be like a temporary takeover almost, where, you know, I don't know, the leopard might go off exploring somewhere else, find another male leopard, come into his territory and slowly regain it. I don't think it's quite as clear-cut as we tend to think it is always. Isn't that nice? Listen to them talking to each other. They're a very, very closely knit family. Just keeping in contact with each other. I used to think this was some kind of a dharm call, but I don't think it is. We've been doing this since we saw them. We saw the same flock yesterday at the bottom of this road, and then just before we got off to look at those leopard tracks, we saw them halfway up this road. And now it's the same one foraging in a northerly direction, just scanning the leaves of these strychnos bushes all around us here. These are all horrible strychnos bushes. And if you have a child with a birthmark that is disfiguring, remember, this apparently is the tree that it is used to cure that problem. All right, let's go across to Jamie and find out what she's got.
Don't have anything really, except for still relatively crackly communications, but we have arrived at the very much totally dry Buffalo Dam, the sort of top corner of our traverse on Cheetah Plains. And I always feel whenever I come here, first of all, it's really beautiful and it's got some lovely old jackalberries and leadwoods, but it just always seems like such a perfect spot for a leopard to be hiding away somewhere. Although if I were a leopard in this weather, I'd be looking for the best patch of sun possible to warm up. Otherwise, Cheetah Plains today is relatively quiet. I haven't even seen any tracks of anything wandering through. Let's continue our investigation. We're about to pop out into what's known as Nkoro Open Area. We're not on Nkoro, we're just south of it. There's a beautiful open spot. Now, Dave thinks he saw something moving on back towards south, towards the Mala Mala boundary, so we're going to do a big loop. And then head towards that direction, if we can't figure out what it was. By the way, we did spend a considerable period of time, we spotted something on a termite mound that looked totally out of place. I was convinced it was a kill, or even something man-made that had been left on a stump. It wasn't, it was a piece of bark that was haloed in the morning light, that looked like it really looked like a dead inyala, but it was a tree that had fallen over and the bark had peeled back. But it's amazing how something like that, that's very clearly out of place, immediately jumps out at you when you're driving through the bush. I also really, really like this part of Cheetah Plains with its bright red soils. There's a lot more, that red color comes from the iron in it, and it's essentially because there's a little bit less rainfall in this area. One of the reasons is because, apart from the underlying geology, There's a little bit less rainfall in this part of Cheetah Plains, which means the soils don't get leached as much as they do towards Juma and the other parts of our traverse area. They maintain this beautiful red color. And of course, while we drive along here, I'm always hopeful for a chance to see Inkanyeni and her cubs, since I haven't managed to do that yet. Or Quarantine, or Shimbambalana. All three of those leopards I have yet to encounter. Now they're on my list of animals I really, really want to see. Just something interesting. Sorry. Something I don't think we've seen yet on Cheetah Plains is a hyena. And yet the place is full of middens. There's one. There's evidence of them absolutely everywhere. Their tracks are everywhere. And we're trying to work out if Cheetah Plains falls under the territory of the Juma clan, or if it's a little bit far, and if there's another clan that is maybe Kruger-based that moves through here. There's an old hyena den site somewhere on this in this area, but there's no active dens as far as we know, but I'm quite keen to see hyena as well. We're still getting to grips with the dynamics of Cheetah Plains. Okay, come on, Beanie. Stop trying to cover my eyes. It's not going to help at all. But what it does mean is because there's been very little water in this area with the red soils, the grasses are not particularly nutritious. And then we start to move out towards the clearing and you see the better grasses growing once again. And back onto the open area that serves as the boundary between our traverse area and Nkoro, the lodge or piece of land that is directly to the north of us here. Surprised that the clearings are so devoid of animals. I would have expected them to all be here warming up since there's no more wind. Oh, but the lapwings are having a bit of an argument. A bit of a territorial dispute happening. Well done, Dave. Very vocal birds, absolutely not afraid of a confrontation. Earth are you fussing about? Well, they've been terribly up. I think it's a dispute between several different pairs of lapwings. So what's got them making such a fuss? Whoa. Their aerial acrobatics is quite astounding. Look at that landing. Perfect. Okay. Dispute settled. We can move on. That's a noise. The cry of a crowned lapwing is the sound I will always associate with my childhood of walking through school fields and running away from the lapwings dive bombing you as a child, and especially growing up in Johannesburg. And Dave, you also grew up in Johannesburg. Yeah. Yeah. Will be forever that is what I always, it brings back those memories so clearly. And it was always a winter morning somehow. Those really cold high felt mornings, which are definitely colder than our mornings here. You wrapped up in your school uniform dodging lapwings. Okay, a thorough check of the clearings has been carried out. There's no tracks. most things have been hiding away just because of the wind. Right, let's go. While we head back towards where Dave saw movement, let's go back over to James, find out how he's doing on Juma.
I'm interested that there is a wind on Cheetah Plains. Here it is completely still. I don't know why the animals would be hiding, other than perhaps not so much for the wind, but for the cold. And I said, I described the other day how, you know where we should go. I described how taking game drives in the middle of a little bit difficult. Sorry about that, everybody. We are in the Twin Dams region, and signal can be a little dodgy here. Now, if I was a lion and I wanted to sort of enjoy my Monday morning, I'd probably be sitting on top of that wall, absorbing the sun, and maybe roaring a little bit. So let's go and see if that's what they're doing. This is roundabout where Herbert thought he heard the soft call. Not the roar, but a call of a lion.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
And those other two that we saw yesterday. Oh, I'm just listening to Herbert. Karula's crossed south, out of the property, I'm afraid. Just listening? Yeah, with the babies. So unfortunately, that's that for that search. Lionesses, I think, have been found on Torchwood, fast asleep. There were three yesterday lurking around the Gari cut line with Jamie, and I don't know where the third one is. We haven't found her tracks yet, so I don't know. It's all rather confusing. Right, let us pretend we are male lions, Vim. Oh, I can hear Boone's alarm calling. There. You hear the baboons? There, you can hear them now. Bow! Bow! They can see that male lion. That unfortunately is south of the boundary where we're allowed to go. So we can't go there. But the male lion, well, it can absolutely go there, and I suspect that's precisely what it's done. It's just very nice sitting here in the sun. Isn't it, Vim?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Defrosting.
Yes, defrosting. Ah. Right, on we go. Enough messing about the place. Michael, I think you had a question about male lion coalitions and when it is, how often the takeovers happen. Normally, Michael, a male lion can hold a territory for sort of 2.5 to 3 years. And in the case of the Birminghams, they may have held on to a bit longer. The Majinga Lion Coalition has managed to hold on to their territory for, I think, almost 5 or 6 years now. They're in the western sector of the Sabi Sand, so that is quite unusual. But they seem to be a
Oh, it seems as though we lost James there. We do have some lovely, if somewhat nervous, kudu. I'm trying to work out what's got them so upset, because they're not really looking at... They are looking at us, obviously, but they also keep looking off into the distance to the east of them. And something's unsettled them. It might just be because they're in an open area, and as an animal that is geared towards hiding in dense vegetation. Oh, I see the reason. I think I know exactly what's bothering. There, he's coming out now. Hello, boy. Are you tormenting the ladies? You're causing them distress. I think we have a courting kudu bull. Wait, ladies, wait! I'm coming! Wait for me! Slowing to a sedate but eager. Oh, no, eager trot, eager trot. A couple of little ones there as well. Oh, caught up. And in the distance, a ground hornbill calling somewhere. He's caught up with the lady I think he was aiming for. She doesn't seem terribly impressed by his intentions, but he's going to try anyway. Oh. Have a good sniff. I'm going to get a Fleming grimace. Yes, little Fleming grimace. And immediately she instinctively lifts her tail. She might even urinate in response. But I don't think, I think he's a little bit eager. I'm not sure she's all that keen on his attentions. Keeping pace with her. Well, I think we probably have found the reason for their slight jumpiness. Like most male antelope, a male kudu, when faced with the prospect of a female coming into estrus, can get a little bit, how do I put it, over-enthusiastic, maybe a little bit pushy is perhaps another way of describing it. We've seen the impala chase the females around endlessly over the last few months. And kudu don't have a strict breeding season, but a lot of them are coming into estrus now so that they can time the birth of their babies with our wet season, where they have the most access to resources. Alright, just keep our eyes peeled in the trees or on the ground for that hornbill that is calling. It's the biggest species of hornbill that occurs here, the southern ground hornbill. We see them very often along the southern boundary of Cheetah Plains, so they're here somewhere. One of our most critically endangered bird species. I think they're a little bit more towards the boundary. Last time I was on these open clearings, the wind was howling across the plains. It was thoroughly unpleasant. This is a totally different experience. It's beautiful, and now much, much warmer than when we first started. Okay, Dave, am I going to veer right or left here? Just left. Perfect. Thank you. Let's see if we can't figure out what was there. And when we're finished double-checking where Dave spotted movement, we have a giraffe that's going to slowly make its way towards us. Awesome, look how they stick out like that. That's really, really cool. I love these open areas. They are all the way in the distance there. Gives me a chance to listen for the hornbill as well. A giraffe and her offspring, by the looks of it. Mammoth-sized difference between the two. All the way on Mana Mana. And slowly making their way across to Cheetah Plains. Oh, look at the little one. Still got that disproportionate look that baby giraffe have. Slightly stumpier necks, but legs almost as long as Mom. It makes them look very strange in comparison. Wonderful. Okay. We'll wait for them to make their way a bit closer. I think they are going to. They've spotted us. See where they go. While we wait, let's go investigate. While we wait for them to get closer, James is doing something, or something's happening with James, or James would like to update you. I'm not entirely sure. Let's find out.
Elephants, everybody. We've come onto Ledwood Road. We were very sad at the news that Karula and the cubbies have gone south to Little Gowrie, but here we find ourselves with some elephants. Now, we were originally arrested by the activities of two young bulls over there, and they were fighting with each other. They now seem to be ashamed and feeding, and I would go a little bit forward, but we will drive right into the others. So I think we'll just wait for them to cross the road. These two bulls were having a right old tussle. They're young. That activity there is showing this mate that he's very strong. This will be worth watching to see if they don't carry on at it. They're probably about 13 years old each, 12 or 13. There in the background, you may have been able to hear the rather impressive sound of an elephant letting fly, as it were. Let me go forward a bit. Here we go. Much anger. They're not that keen on having a box anymore there, and I can just make out the fact that the bull that we've been watching has put his trunk into the other one's mouth. And that's just how they greet each other. It's a beautiful scene, starting to warm up a bit now. Let's move a bit forward. The rest of the herd is up here. Those ones, you could just see they turned round as we came into this area. Just turned to look, but they're pretty relaxed with us. They don't seem to be in the slightest worried.
Now they're fighting.
Yes, now they're having a big box. Suddenly, now that we're not looking. There we go. I wish they'd come and do it in the open. And that's very typical. It's just exactly the same as human children or human teenagers having a bit of a box, trying to establish some kind of physical dominance. Let me get out of the way of these ones. The sun is starting to warm us quite nicely now. Don't be tempted, I know you are. I'm just putting my other hat on everybody up there. The audio is getting a little bit scrunchy. Sorry about that. I apologize. apologise. Oh, sorry, nearly done. There we go. Thank you, Bill. That's very kind of you. Yeah, you could have had me there. This is fantastic. I'm just going to turn the game drive radio down. It's extremely loud. There do seem to be lions all over Torchwood. We can't go there, but we've got wonderful elephants here. Now, where we're sitting is just next to a tree that I'm very sad to see was pushed over. There used to be, there was at one stage, we had a wonderful sighting of the quarantine male leopard, Karula's son and Mvula's son, in that tree. And then one of these elephants came and pushed it over. So the chances of us seeing another leopard in that tree, obviously very, very small. That's a very artistic shot you've got going there, VM. Very nice. I might take a picture of it. What you wouldn't have heard there, everybody, was the almost audible sound of VM sighing as I announced that I was going to take a picture. This is because VM has very little respect for my picture-taking skills, and that is for good reason. No, my lens is not wide enough. I will leave that picture because VM took such a nice artistic shot there. And it just reminds me, everybody, so many of you take such wonderful screenshots and post them all over social media, and it's always great fun to see them. It's always slightly embarrassing also when your screenshots taken from the United States or Finland or Australia or New Zealand are better than the photographs I take when I'm actually here. Dina, a nice one from you about the state of nutrition in this area. You say, well, these yellow leaves have slightly less nutrition in them than the green ones. Absolutely, and you can taste it. They also have far fewer chemical compounds for defense, so they've got much less in the way of tannin. So they are edible, certainly, but they've definitely got less nutrients in them. If you think about it, the nutrients within a plant in the cells, in the cytoplasm of the cells, is normally made up of carbohydrates. So it'll be some kind of sugars, various kinds of complex sugars in the leaves. And there'll be vitamins and minerals and all that sort of thing as well. But once a tree dies, once the leaf dies, it desiccates. So it's no longer fed with water, it's no longer can produce carbohydrates, it no longer can produce nutrients. And so that yellowing tree is a desiccating, drying leaf, and then sorry everybody, my attention was completely distracted by the sound of VM's belly giving the loudest growl I've heard since I was last chased by a female lion. I did not dissuade you. Now, get back to the story. The brown leaves, of course, are largely structural material. Now, that's just cellulose and lignin. That's why they survive when an animal cell. So if you, for example, this is going to sound a bit stupid, but if you toss a stake out here into the bush and a branch of a tree, you break a branch off, the leaves are going to last much longer than the meat will. The meat will disintegrate because it doesn't have a strong cell wall made of lignin and cellulose, and so that will disappear. And the brown stuff is basically just that structural material, which is almost impossible for these animals to try and digest. That's why they've got so much in the way of bacteria in their bellies. I'm just going to sneak forward because I think there's a small knobthorn tree about to come off second best against some others. Just ease forward. We don't want to make them uncomfortable, and we are kind of in the middle of them now, which is not always the best place to be for their comfort, but they seem to be okay, so we'll just wait here. I'm Those two bulls are still at it, actually. Naturally, in the thickest bush they can find. Now, let's watch them eat here. Watch what they are eating. So, trying to eat some of the leaves. But if you watch carefully, a lot of the leaves are discarded. And it's the bark. And this elephant, despite the fact being probably about four years old, is still not as dexterous with its trunk as it might be. Look at that. Just watch carefully which part of this tree the elephant's going to eat. This is fantastic. I often have to pinch myself, you know, to make myself realize that that is a real live elephant. I'm sitting only about 8 meters from it, and this is what I do for a living. All around the world, there are people having an immeasurably worse Monday morning than you and I are experiencing right now. See, not eating a huge amount of the leaves, largely trying to get at the bark. Michael, there are two aspects to your question that I think are very interesting. Look at you, Vim. There's only one way to describe that, and that is itchy ass. That is amazing. Michael, you're interested in whether or not these elephants are able to recognize individual human voices. Michael, I don't know. I would say that it is possible, but you say that you certainly think that they are intelligent enough. Remember, and I've been reading quite a lot about this lately, intelligence, of course, is very much a subjective thing. And it very much, and certainly the way human beings describe it, is, it's narrow. It's narrowly defined. From a human point of view, we tend to define intelligence very broadly as sort of problem-solving ability or ability to do arithmetic or linguistic problems. From that point of view, I think you'll probably find elephants are quite intelligent. And I think that their ability to communicate, though, is possibly their greatest intelligence. And I've got no reason to suspect that they can't hear individual voices. I know that some people are attacked more often than others by elephants, and they don't seem to, you know, there seems to be no real reason for that. And I know that one of the best guides I ever worked with used to work at Londolozi, and no matter what she did, elephants just took a dislike to her. And so I've no doubt they recognize something. We like, I think, as human beings to, we like to think that the animals recognize us, that they know who we are, especially something like the leopards. And I mean, I know a lot of you have made comments like, look at them. And now having a proper box, obviously behind a tree. But I know many of you have said things like, made comments like, you know, she has shown her cubs to you when we've spoken about Karula. And, you know, there is an element there of liking to think that she's chosen to bring the cubs out and display them to us, that she knows where we are. This is when we're talking of Karula, of course, and that she knows who she's showing the cubs to. Is that true? I don't know. Maybe it is. But look at these elephants. They're having a very intimate little interaction there, saying hi. And the trunk in the mouth there is how they say hello to each other. And remember, they also have a very important vomeronasal organ, That's that organ of Jacobson. It's extremely important to elephants. So when they put their trunks in each other's mouths, they'll then put their trunks into their own mouths and they interpret the scent from the other elephant in that way. I don't know exactly what sense they're interpreting, but that's what they're doing. Now, I would really like it if these two idiots came out into the open and stood a bit of fighting there. While we wait for them to do that, let's head across to Jamie. She's found an impala on Cheetah Plains.
I found a couple of impala. Wait, one's choked on the water. She breathed it in the wrong pipe, so she's having a little bit of a cough. Oh, she seems fine now. Impala milling about, coming through for a drink at three in a row pan, in standard impala fashion, which is to panic at the slightest movement. And it's the instinctive reticence of all animals when approaching a murky body of water, in case there is a crocodile lurking. Unlikely at three in a row pan, but you never know. Never underestimate a body of water in the African bush, because crocodiles can cover enormous distances, and they sometimes turn up where you least expect them. I'm relatively certain there's no crocodiles there, but the impala don't quite share my confidence. We've got, as well as James's elephants sparring, we've actually got some young males who are doing it as well, half-heartedly, kicking up dust. Laying down a challenge. Skip, skip, snort. Oh, poor Dave is at a terribly awkward. Oh, now, third has joined the fray. Oh, no, now not what? Okay, we'll take turns challenging each other. Shame, sorry, Dave. I know it's a very awkward angle for you. But if we move, they're going to stop what they're doing. The rest of them, sort of latecomers to the waterhole, have decided to come and have a quick drink. All in that very nervous way, ready to jump out of the way at the slightest movement. Beautiful. It's a very peaceful morning out here. Earlier we saw the nervous and somewhat courting kudu, and now we have impala having a quick drink. And Joey, something that we always forget about is the fact that you don't really get a sense of scale when you're watching through the camera lens. So Joey would like to know what the size comparison is between an impala and a kudu. A big kudu bull compared to an impala ram is about 4 times the weight and much, much taller. But what I'll do for you, Joey, when these impala... Oh, they're all coming back now. I was about to say when they leave, but they've all decided to return. Very fast, actually. They'll come back from where they've just run off to. There's got to be a big ram there causing trouble to result in this rush back to the water. Oh my word, they just keep coming. Ah, I can hear the reason why they're all dashing back this way. There's an impala male grunting off in the distance somewhere. Chaos reigns at the waterhole, a scene that was initially so pleasant and peaceful. The males are still a bit confused because it's not rutting season. It's finished now, but the males are still bound by the call of hormones, and they're chasing all of the females around. I'm going to start heading across in this direction, so I'm not repositioning just yet. They're going to make their way. Actually, this is beautiful. Panic. Okay. Unnecessary panic, we'll go back. Joey, what I was going to say was I'll get out and I'll give you an indication using my height, just how tall an impala is compared to a kudu. There's one of the full-grown rams. They're absolutely magnificent. For newer viewers who've missed out on the last few months of action, we've just come through impala breeding season, their rutting season. And during that time, the males go absolutely crazy. They chase the females away, they collect their harem. Oh, there's a one-horned impala. Sometimes losing their horns in the process of the rut. It's a unicorn. A mysterious unicorn impala. I've got a few of those wandering about. Shame. Imagine having to be constantly on this level of alertness. It pays to panic if you're an impala, because one day that panic might actually be real. So yes, we've come to the end of the breeding season, but the impala rams are still a bit confused. They still feel that instinct to fight and to chase the ladies, even though it's not going to have any kind of effect, because the females' estrus cycles are done, and most of the females that you're looking at now are pregnant. Impala have a sort of a roughly 80 to 90% success rate when it comes to fertilization. So all of the adult females, or almost all of the adult females, are now carrying little lambs. And if you keep watching, you'll be treated to the spectacle of impala lambing season in November, where they all start to give birth at roughly the same time. Impala are on basically everybody's menu. Any predator out here eats an impala. Favorite food of leopards, particularly large male leopards, and definitely something enjoyed by crocodiles, lions, cheetah. Shame. So they do lead very nervous lives, and for a jolly good reason. It's a scary, scary place out there in the wild for an impala. Now the amazing thing about an impala, and they're probably going to be the ones, in terms of the herbivores, that sort of survive this drought in the best condition. They've got a system that has remained unchanged for thousands and thousands of years. And they're actually, whilst they do drink every day if they can, they're not totally water dependent. On the subject of our pregnant females, Dina would like to know if they need to drink more water. Probably, but not an enormously noticeable amount, Dina, as far as I know. I'm not 100% certain on that. But I imagine they might need... Of course, they will need extra nutrients. It stands to reason that a little bit of extra water would go a long way. But I don't think it will be a dramatic increase in the amount that they drink. I'm going to reposition now because... The males that I thought were going to come and drink haven't done so. They're still chasing each other around. And they're watched by a couple of very bemused zebra. Let us go back a little bit and have a look at what's happening there. And then, Joey, I promise, once I move on and I don't want to risk scaring animals, I'll give you a bit of a size comparison. I'm going to stop here just so that we can get an overview of what's going on. There's just utter chaos at the back there. The impala rams still chasing each other around. And then, as I said, some bemused zebra, if you look carefully. They also want to come and drink, but they've been distracted by the antics of the impalas. lots of vocalizations happening. Well, since most of our impala and our zebra appear to have disappeared into the vegetation, let's go back over to James and his elephants.
There, everybody, is an elephant. This is a different herd of elephants. It's Elephant Day here at Juma Private Game Reserve. And this chap is a young bull, and he seems to be quite enamored with us. He's having his breakfast. Also of Cumbritum trees. He's a rather splendid fellow. Vim, I knew you were going to do that to me.
I walked out of shot. What do you want me to do?
Go to those elephants. I was taking a slow-mo, everybody, with my selfie stick. That's actually a really nice little scene going on there. Look at this. Look at the bull going up to the little one. Now, Pinchy Whiner's Hat, I think you've asked a very crucial and very clever question here. You said, why is it that elephants seem to capture our attention the way they do? Why do they affect us emotionally in the way that they do? Is there some kind of evolutionary reason for it? I don't know. I know exactly what you mean. I think that they are just, it's something about the way they interact with each other. I do believe that they communicate with us on a level that we don't understand. I mean, almost as a, you know, a sort of like a sixth sense, if you know what I mean. Because we get an impression from elephants, from being around them. And I think absolutely there's some kind of communication that takes place there that we find very appealing. And why that should sort of capture our... I guess the other reason, of course, is that their social structure is such that we can identify with it. We can... Please don't push that tree over. He's going to, isn't he? They have a social structure that we identify with a very caring sort of matriarchal society, which in very much mirrors a sort of a Stone Age society, if you like, of human beings, where it was largely matriarchal, with the men spending much less time with the rest of the herd. Sorry, I got completely distracted there for a second, because I think Louise has observed that elephant we're looking at now has the bottom half of her trunk missing. And so that's probably our friend, the two-thirds trunk that looks like her, actually. Some right-sized tusks. Let's just look for the notch. She's got a notch in one of hers, I seem to remember. Maybe she doesn't. So Pinchy Whiner's Hat, just to get back to what you were saying there. So she is definitely missing a piece of her trunk there. I think that's probably the cow that we know quite well. And this is maybe a bull that's joined up with them. Their social structure, like I said, I've just got myself completely confused there. So human societies, of course, prior to the advent of the industrial age and what we call civilization, but was in fact inescapably uncivilized, certainly used to live in societies where the females were a massively important part of the village, and the men used to spend extended periods on their own without the rest of the human tribe, if you like. And I think that quite mirrors elephant society, and also The fact that they have this habit of mourning their dead, of looking after their youngsters, of adopting orphans, I think those habits all combine to make us that much more attached to them. He's an impressive young bull, this. He's got quite long tusks. I wonder if he isn't the chap we saw the other day when he was looking after a herd. We were sitting not too far from here, and I got into the car when I heard them coming, and we had this amazing sort of experience where it was four young elephants, and this bull, and he seemed to be looking after them. They weren't old enough to have a herd of their own. You think that's the same one, Viam?
No.
I think it's a different one. I think that's another one that's missing the base of her trunk there. I'm not sure that that's our normal friend. The calf is the right age, that's correct. That tree is copping it horribly. Well, there are elephants everywhere. I can hear them all around us, which is just fantastic. From here, we're going to head to Biffleshook Dam and see if we can't find the male leopard they saw so much earlier. And Anne, you ask a question about whether or not I think elephants are able to sense fear in human beings. Anne, can they sense fear? Yeah, I think they probably can, you know. I think that they're tremendously astute, and the same way that you can maybe not sense it, but maybe they can probably read it from body language. They can probably hear it, infer it from tone of voice. I think that certainly could be possible. Can they sense it? They might be able to just sense it. I think to a large extent, you know, like when you say, well, a dog can sense fear. I don't think they sense fear at all. I think that they just read body language. They can tell. They're predators. So they know when something is afraid of them, and they'll push home that advantage. And I think it's much more to do with body language than it is to do with actually sensing it. Because you can be as terrified as you like of a dog, but if you stand up tall and don't let that fear sort of affect the way you interact with it, well, it'll generally leave you alone. So, yeah, can they sense fear? I don't know. Can they read it? Definitely. I think they're tremendously astute with each other as well. And like I say, they seem to you know, to a certain extent, if they're not particularly tense, if they're not that worried about life, if they don't perceive any threat from you, and if you approach them and speak with a quiet voice, and you don't make a noise, and you drive slowly, they definitely pick up on that, and they appreciate that. And I think that's, you know, it's part of the same sort of suite of senses that they'd use to sense whether something was upset or angry or afraid. And remember, a leopard is not, an elephant is not a predator. So even if they were to feel or sense fear, it wouldn't necessarily mean that they'd then sort of push home some kind of attack, which is precisely what a predator would do. Quite the opposite. They might seek to, they might actually see, and I don't know this for sure by any stretch, but they might seek to dissuade you from being afraid of them, and they might change their body language. They might actually move away from you. Unless they were very angry. It's turned into the most gorgeous morning. I don't know why or how it's windy on Cheetah Plains, but it's just so very still here. I guess it must be those open areas that are conjuring up the odd breeze. It's so peaceful. All right, let's go to Biffleshook Dam. Let's go and see if we can't find a leopard there. Like I say, there was a leopard there earlier this morning, but it disappeared before, I mean, as it was called in on the radio, it disappeared, so I didn't rush over this way. Two or three people did try and look for it. I'm just going to observe as we go past and see if I can't make out whether that is our cow or not. I think it is. as Viam says, the right calf is the right age. And, you know, she is normally part of a herd of four of them. And I think you'll find that as the winter progresses, the dry season progresses, so she may well join up with other herds. And with young bulls like that. I've missed exactly what we're going across to. I do know that it's Jamie, but I'm not sure what she's going to show you. Let's find out.
Well, in that case, our warthog should come as a lovely surprise to you all. A really sweet little family, a female and her one remaining piglet, and then a boar that is quite a young one. He is also keeping the rest of this group company. And there's something moving in the back. Oh, it's a dacre. That's what it is. It's at the back on the other side of the drainage line, hidden away. Keep your eye out for a little bit of movement. There you go, boar on the left. Middle one is the little piglet. And there's Mom. It's an animal I always really, really enjoy seeing. We take them for granted and they've got a reputation for being relatively ugly. I can't say that they're beautiful, but they are phenomenally interesting to watch as they snuffle through and look for any shoots or tubers or anything else that they can find. Using those specially adapted hocks that they lean on. Here goes the big boar at the back. Mom and Piglet with their bristly manes. The wonderful thing about this camera is it also gives us such a beautiful way of closely looking at the animals. We don't always get to do that, but there you can see the bottom tusks of the female, razor sharp, much, much sharper than the top set of tusks that are more for show than anything else. It's the bottom ones you've got to watch out for. Their whiskers and sideburns. And then the really bristly, thick mane that runs along their bodies. And if you were extra specially observant, you might even have seen the residual toes that warthog have. They have that in common with buffalo. There you go, look there. Now that's actually something, because warthogs love to wallow in mud. You very often see a warthog's hoof prints accompanied by the second little set of residual toes. A throwback to a time where their feet were differently evolved. And of course the hoof structure that our antelope and our buffalo and our warthog have, that's actually one of the most highly evolved, apparently, the most highly evolved foot structures. So we've got one of the most basic, we're called plantigrades. So we have flat feet. Then you've got the digitigrades of the paws of the big cats, where they've got very, very extended metatarsals and metacarpals, and that they can walk essentially on their tiptoes. And then you've got the hoof structure, which is walking on tiptoes, but just two tiptoes. And that is an adaptation for speed and agility. The paw, like a leopard or a lion, is adapted for stealth. And this will be the last remaining piglet of hers. Look how fluffy its belly is. The warthog piglets have a tough time of things. Life's not all that easy for them. Everything wants to eat a warthog piglet, especially our leopards out here. As they kneel forward, they're giving us a really nice answer to Brian Palmer's question.
Oh, I know him.
Hmm?
I know him.
You know him?
Yes.
You know, Dave knows Brian Palmer.
I do.
Hello, Brian Palmer. Dave says hi. How do you know him, Dave?
Oh, we used to work together.
Oh, okay. How awesome is that? We used to work together with Dave. So a small little old world, this. Well, Brian would like to know, on the subject of his question, how are you doing, Dave?
Very well, very well.
Very well. Brian did actually want to know whether or not a warthog has to kneel in order to feed. No, they don't. It just is an adaptation, or an adaption, if you want to actually use the correct pronunciation of that word, to getting their snout closer to the ground. It's a little bit easier for them in terms of their design of their faces and their backs, but they don't have to, and they often don't. If they're feeding on the run, then they'll just bend down and pick up little bits of grass before moving on. But if they've got a long time period spent foraging in the same place as these guys do, then they will kneel forward and snuffle, I think is the best way of describing what they do. Very sensitive noses, as all pigs have, geared towards being able to smell beneath the surface of the soil whether or not there's anything worth digging for. And they are very accomplished diggers. And they often excavate ex-aardvark holes in termite burrows or termite mounds, and that's where they spend their nights rather than trying to hide out in the open as night falls. And I would say that warthogs have been responsible for probably about 40% of the big frights I've had whilst I've been walking. Franklin are responsible for 50%, and 10% have been actual big animals. Most of the surprises you get on foot are from the smaller creatures, and it's usually a warthog exploding out of its burrow, having decided that you've got too close. And let me tell you, that definitely raises the heart rate several steps. There was one hilarious bushwalk I went with. Steph and I went with. But it was Brian on camera and Brent was conducting the walk. And we all were clustered on a termite mound, and a warthog came flying out between all four of us. And we shot off in different directions. I think we all levitated that day up back further onto the termite mound. It was most impressive, of course, was Brian, who was carrying the bushwalk backpack at the time. It's amazing how fast you move when you feel that you need to. Adrenaline does wonderful things to one's speed of motion. Okay, warthogs have gone into the drainage line. Let's go see what else we can find. Might go through a bit of a patchy signal spot here. While we navigate around, James Richard, wondering if warthogs ever scent mark. They do actually have scent glands between their toes, known as pedals, but they're not really terrible. Nice and close to us, yeah? Perfectly relaxed. They're not really territorial creatures, so they don't scent mark as frequently in the way that the leopards or lions or other territorial antelope might. Oh, they're so nice and relaxed with people. This is wonderful. When I first started working at Wild Earth, a warthog sighting like this was an exceptional rarity. They used to run as soon as they saw vehicles. Don't know what that was all about or why it was, but we've got a few families now that are totally relaxed with the presence of vehicles. It's usually the females and the youngsters. The males don't tend to stick around for as long. Little one, under 6 months old, still dependent on mom, although fully weaned, hasn't yet got the fearsome tusks. Cute. And this little piglet probably came from a litter of three or four, which is the average size for warthogs. Of course, they are part of the pig family. We get two different types of pigs in this area. One is the warthog that we see commonly. The other is the bush pig, which we hardly ever see and is more closely related to the wild hogs and boars that you might be more familiar with in Europe and the North Americas. Steve, you were wondering if warthogs are as destructive to the environment as the types of wild pigs are in your side of the world. The answer is no, they're not. They're also far less aggressive, and they don't damage food sources for other animals. Their population is kept well in check by the delicate balance of predator and prey out here. And what I mean by that is that there's not enough warthog to cause huge damage to the environment. They're also much, much smaller than most of the wild pig species. They're only mostly a sort of an average of about 100-odd pounds per animal. And not a huge amount that they eat. So whilst they do damage the growth points of grasses and roots and shoots, it's a natural part of the system, and they're not overpopulated. So they're not nearly quite so capable of causing damage. That little one is so cute. She's just starting to get her tusks. So around 6 months of age. Probably quite a late birth. Most of the warthog piglets by now, from last year's sort of offspring, are past that age. But this little one's still got the well-developed cheek fuzz, which is meant to look like intimidating tusks. Doesn't work all that well. And she's got a while to... not that long, but she is starting to get her tusks. It's poking through the groove there. Now and again, you might be able to see it. It just depends on the angle that she's at. Snuffling away. We're going to leave our little warthog family to their breakfast. In the meantime, I'm actually quite jealous of James. He seems to be having a pachyderm-filled Monday. Let's go across. He's found some more elephants for you.
When we found these elephants, or when we bumped into them, VM said, "Oh, not again." But there are elephants absolutely everywhere. They stopped when they heard us coming. It's a small herd. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Oh, there are a few of them through the middle there. Isn't that nice? Now, we're not far from Biffleshoek Dam, and apparently it was Gejima that they saw around here going west from the dam. He may come back into this area. So we're in that area now. Let's just have a very careful look around. Apparently he was quite nervous of the vehicles, and we know that this is the area that he does come into. And for those of you who don't know, Gejima, we reckon, is probably about somewhere between 5 or 7. Hold on a second. Herbert's trying to get hold of me. Go ahead. Sorry, Herbie, I missed that. Go again.
Your location?
I'm at Biffleshoek Dam. You can hear him now.
Okay, thanks.
Is that all you need to know? He's just wondering where I am.
Symmetry.
Okay, copy, thanks, Herb. I think he's just making sure that he's working a different part of the reserve from the rest of us. Okay, so Gejima, 5 to 7 year old male leopard, not quite territorial yet, moving into what was traditionally, I guess, Mvula's territory. And unfortunately, I think because he probably comes from the Kruger, he's not habituated to vehicles, and he gets a bit nervous around us, and so it's going to take a little bit of time for him to get used to us. But because he spends so little time here, it's unlikely that he's going to get that used to us in the same way that Tingana will lie right next to the vehicle and not even look what we're doing. I always think it's quite nice to see an animal like that, because it just does remind you of the wilderness and how wild this area is. Right, we're approaching Biffleshoek Dam. Sorry about that, everybody. I'm not sure why Wendy is so recalcitrant in this particular area. But here is the dam, and there is a grey heron that Wim has spotted. I'm just going to keep going and then you might get another shot of it there in the tree. Roger in Tampa, nice question. You say, how is it that a male leopard dies? What is the major cause of death? Is it old age, other leopards, lions, perhaps, maybe hyenas? I'd say it's largely hyenas, you know. Yes, they will be chased out of an area by another male leopard, but it's unlikely that another male would kill them, mainly because the male leopards of the area don't like to fight. If they fight, they take too many risks, so they rather avoid fighting. And so it's much more likely to be a lion or a hyena. Not a hyena, many hyena. So a few birdies here. We've got the Egyptian gooses, but otherwise all is quiet. Now what I was hoping was to see the dappled spots of Gejima, the male leopard, down there in the drainage, because that's apparently where he went off. But he's not there. And the hippopotamus seems to have moved from here as well. In fact, there's almost nothing going on here whatsoever. Right, let's go to the end of the dam, or we'll turn around and come back the other way. I was hoping to find a great plethora of activity here. It's a perfect place to come and have your breakfast, everybody. So if you are thinking about having breakfast, well, I'd pack a picnic and come along here and enjoy the atmosphere of this glorious morning. Cool. Going to be a nice warm day, I think, as long as the wind doesn't pick up. Yeah, well, there's very little in the way of track here. The male leopard apparently went down through there like that, into the drainage, and he was impossible to follow, of course, because it is very thick. Now, he was identified by a Bufasuk landowner, who I'm not sure has seen him before, and so it could well have been Tingana. You know, impossible to follow a leopard into this drainage area. It's completely impossible. So we'll go down that way. You will lose signal with us, I think, eventually. But if we get very lucky, hopefully we'll find some signal at the same time. We should be okay for the next little while, though. I've taken my
We're in the area where I last saw Tundi on Cheetah Plains. I'm just checking really, really carefully in this drainage line around Juma Dam, strangely enough, to see if she hasn't hidden here somewhere. And the reason I say that is because when we saw her, she was looking extraordinarily pregnant. And I spoke to Andrew from Cheetah Plains. He's a guide at Cheetah Plains, and he tells me that she has denned in this area before. We're keeping an eye out for her. Obviously, we're not going to be poking our noses into all of the crevices. We don't want to disturb her or upset her if she's just had cubs. But it's nice to just come through and see if there's any tracks to give us an indication that she has been around here. So far, all quiet. As we make our way out of Juma Dam and back onto the other side of the drainage line. So basically the overflow system that feeds the dam. And Tundi, of course, for those of you who are unfamiliar, is a female leopard. She is the oldest daughter of Karula. She's the twin sister of Shadow, whose territory is around Arethusa. I've seen her a couple of times on Cheetah Plains, and when we did see her last, she was looking spectacularly pregnant, almost uncomfortably so. And this is the perfect spot to hide out cub secret. Lots of rock crevices and dense vegetation to hide them away. And obviously, as we went through Juma Dam and we had a look for Tundi, you can see just how dry things have really become. And Ginny in the UK, welcome as always to the Sunrise Safari. Now, apparently you've been to South Africa a couple of times. There's been a water shortage, except for the time where there was some severe floods 2 years ago. And I was here for those floods. They were quite extraordinary. I ended up being trapped and unable to get to work at one point by river systems that were just overflowing. It was quite the complete opposite end of the spectrum. And you were wondering when last was the drought this bad, and whether or how long it takes the grazing to recover. In theory, a lot of scientists are saying it's probably the worst drought since the last 100 or so years, so in our sort of recorded history for this area. Some are saying it's not that bad. The last bad was 2. No, that's not at all, Jamie. Grazing is for elephants to come through because their diet's going to be largely tree-based. Hopefully they will clear away some of the thicker areas. And in that case, because all of the growth points of the plants are, or the grasses are beneath the surface of the soil, if we get rains this year, they'll probably in most places recover beautifully. The areas around the water points, the water holes, so for example that clearing by the Juma Dam camera, the clearing around Arethusa, all of those open areas, they might take longer because they've had increased hoof action. Lots and lots of animals walking around there, compacting the soil, contributing to the overgrazing and the erosion of those areas. So they'll take longer, they'll take a couple of years, depending on the rains, to actually be restored to their former glory. Most scientists are predicting that we are going to get good rains in the coming year. There's talk of La Nina, the opposite of the El Nino situation, so we might even have excessive rains, which is in itself not ideal because it will wash the topsoil away from those eroded areas and contribute even more so to the destruction of the grazing. The truth is, we just don't know. We'll have to see how things recover. We've changed the nature of the ecosystems in a lot of places so severely that it's a constant learning experience to watch how these ecosystems deal with the climatic conditions thrust upon them. And it's important to remember, of course, that drought has been a reality for this area for years and years, for decades, for hundreds of years. And it just goes through that constant cycle of change and recuperation. Now, in that time in 92, I think the buffalo population in the Kruger National Park dropped by about 60 or 70%, and it has since in the more than 20 years recovered and actually gone past the average or past the maximum that it reached before that drought. So animals recover. Only the strongest will survive in certain species, and the predators will flourish, but everything has got a give and take in nature. And when the grass does recover, there will be less animals utilizing it, which means that the surviving animals will have enormous access to resources and plenty of space to recover. There is talk, many of you will have seen articles about this, and I don't think it's going to come to this, but a lot of smaller reserves, closed systems, are actually thinking of reintroducing a culling system. So taking out population or reducing the numbers of some of the animals to reduce their impact on the natural environment. And there's a great deal of argument against that approach. First of all, it's unnecessary. And second of all, instead of letting nature take out the weakest animals from the selected group, now artificially choosing which ones should be removed from the system. Luckily for us, I don't think that's a problem we're going to have to face at all. We've got this huge open area that will be able to manage itself. The bigger the area, the natural environment, the better it is able to cope with situations like drought without mankind intervening. Well, the nice thing is if we do spot something here, I'm not entirely sure I could call it in. Don't remember what this road is called, but we're almost at the boundary of Annette's and Marla Marla, which is where we saw the Styx Cubs for the first time. I've been listening to the Game Drive channel. You know it's interesting when somebody describes the morning as Lutu, which means nothing. It's all very, very quiet. I wonder where all of the animals have decided to hide. Come on, Dave, you have to spot me a pangolin. You can't see one for Brent and then not spot one for the rest of us. It's favoritism. It's the perfect morning for it. It's still freezing cold. So all of our mystery nocturnal animals are out and about still. So while we look for our mysterious pangolin and possibly other things, you know, we're aiming high. We're really aiming high here. Let's go back over to James for an update.
That is an astronomical aim, everybody. It's not a high aim, it's an astronomical one. We went past Bubbles Duck Dam. As you know, we lost signal there. We found nothing on the way back here. So we're now heading towards the Juma Pan, where apparently there was some gem game. And I'm just hearing reports on the radio now that the lions that they saw on Torchwood, that they found there, they don't actually know the identity of. They're not sure if they're Nkuhuma lionesses or not. Now, it's around where I'm parked right now that the lionesses were found yesterday. And so it might be a good idea just to do a little bit of a turn through here and see what's around. Aubrey did come through here this morning, but that was some time ago and it was very cold, and they may now be lying in the sun. Maybe just up here? No. Well, this is around about where they were. So we'll just do a little turn up the Gari cut line, and then we'll come back towards the Juma Dam. Just keep an eye on the Juma Dam pan cam. Juma Dam pan cam. Oh, VM, you're going to hate me for this. Those things that look like flies in your picture, everybody, are in fact some form of swallow. And what's interesting, of course, is that we don't have the barn swallow. Many of our swallow species migrate, just about all of them, actually. And those, I think, are mosque swallows, two mosque swallows and a juvenile. And what I will do is, first of all, play the call, because I've just heard them call, and we'll just see if we can't get a call there. And then I will show you a picture of them, because you won't be able to identify them from that shot. Fionn, why can't you make them clearer?
Try.
Mm,
didn't work.
Didn't work. Okay, let's hear if we can find a call. Swallow, mosque swallow. Where are you, mosque swallow? Oh dear. Hang on a second, everyone. I'm not doing this very efficiently or fast. No, I can't find the mosque swallow. Does it not exist anymore? They've decided that it's something else now. Red-breasted lizard. Here we go. Mosque. Here we go. Are you listening, everyone? Yeah, that's it. That's what I heard. There, it's calling. There we go. Tick-tick. Cool, so that's the mosque swallow. Now that you've seen it, it looks like a fly in the top of your screen. I'll show you a picture of it in my book. That's him there. The mosque swallow. And one of the only ones that stays here all year round, which I think is quite nice. Isn't that sweet? And they're not common here. I mean, they're common up in sort of the Highveld regions, but up in this area, not so much. I have heard nothing of lions shouting. That is to be expected, I suppose, this time of the day. Anyway, let's ease our way through here. Ha ha ha. Hello, Gary. A lovely question from you about whether or not there are birds here that attack us during the breeding season. There are. Not to the extent that, there are extensive injuries reported by hapless victims of bird attack. But you will find birds like, I know Jamie was showing you some crowned lapwings earlier today on Cheetah Plains. Now, crowned lapwings and their cousins, the blacksmith lapwings, are known for their attacks on people, especially on golf courses, because they like those open areas. And you can be wandering down a fairway if you happen to be able to hit your ball straight enough to be on a fairway, which is not the case with me. And you can be set upon by those birds. And I've actually, where was it? It was somewhere here. I think it was on Biffles Hook Dam Wall, actually. I was attacked by a blacksmith lapwing. Normally they don't actually hit you. They come very close and then they fly off again. And if you move off, then they'll leave you alone. But it does happen. And there's another bird called a red bishop bird, which if you get too close to their nests in the water, and they nest in reeds overhanging water, if you get too close to them, they get very upset indeed, and they'll come bombing towards you. But again, it's very seldom they'll actually hit you. Now, I don't see any evidence of lions here. Ah, yes, wildebeest, you've got some web on your lens there. Right, we're just going to turn around here, I think, and go back towards the Gowrie Dam. I don't see any tracks here. Ooh, well done, James Richard. 162 birds your bird list sits at now. And that's the result of the mosque swallow, number 162. There, the lions. You can see their tracks there, everybody, on Connor's runway. But Jennifer, you also like the swallow, and you say it was a new one for your bird list. There's a lioness track. Let's just get out and assess this. Jennifer, you say that it's a new bird for you, and you notice that they've got a forked tail. They do have forked tails. One second. The reason I'm looking a little nervously around the place is that I thought I spotted a cub track here. And while I'd be very excited to find Karula's cub tracks, a lioness's cub tracks very close to the lioness could easily result in your being attacked and mauled. No, somebody's driven over these already, so they were obviously from this morning sometime. That's all from last night. Were they right here? They could be from last night. I just think there was a bit of a wind last night, and so I'm not sure they'd have been this fresh. Anyway, they were around here. They headed off east. They found two on Torchwood. I don't know if these are the same ones or not. That's the male there. Yeah, just me heading off in that direction there. And there's no access there in a vehicle. Now, forked tails on swallows. There's a very important reason that animals like the swallow have forked tails. And that is because they hawk insects. Now, to hawk insects means you catch them in the air. And to catch an insect in the air, you've all seen how quickly a fly can change direction. You've got to be able to change direction that effectively as well. Now what they do, what that forked tail does, it's not quite forked as it is longer on each side with a sort of curve in the middle. And it allows them to open up the surface or the surface area of the tail very effectively when they're flying and then close it down again. And what that means is that it reduces, they don't have the drag all the time of a long tail or the weight of a fully long tail. So it can be long when they want it to be long, and it can be short almost when they want it to be short. And that's why they are forked. Now these tracks go, the tracks that are going up the road here look to be a bit older. So this is where they were knocking around yesterday, was it, Jim? Alrighty then. We'll turn around here and head back towards the Juma Dam. Next row to vehicles, and if you know that there's look how thick it is. It's extremely kind of a nerve-wracking to go wandering through bush that thick with the and her little cubs in there. Update from Jamie on Cheetah Plains.
While you've been with James, Dave and myself have been exploring, been exploring the southwestern corner of Cheetah Plains, where it meets a farm known as Annette's and Mala Mala, which is where, as I mentioned, we saw the Styx cubs for the first time, or at least a Styx cub. What I can give you an update on is the fact that Tundi also wanted to wander around that area, and she crossed. Her tracks go straight into Annette's. Now, I'm not obviously 100% certain that it is Tundi's tracks. Makes the most sense because it's her territory, this is her territorial area. And also, Tundi's a tiny little leopard. She really is. She is very small. And as a result, her little back track almost looks the size of a cub track. It's about that long. Really small feet that she has. So that was Tundi wandering off into Annette's, just outside of our traverse area. She's not far from the boundary, which means that she could pop back this direction at any point. And it's such a pity because my favorite part of Cheetah Plains is one that we've just come through. There's this wonderful river system. It's dry, obviously, this time of year and this drought. But there's a big dip with some beautiful big tamboti trees and some really interesting landscape. But unfortunately, because it is so topographically interesting, it means that we don't have any signal in that dip. So I can't show you exactly what it is or exactly what it looks like. But I think it might be my favorite little secret spot on Cheetah Plains because nobody seems to ever drive there. There's never car tracks going through. So there we go, we've checked absolutely every single boundary of Cheetah Plains. We've done a full circuit around it, we've checked the on Cheetah Plains. At least we're no longer freezing though, Dave. Hello to AJ as we bump along Cheetah Plains looking for whatever we may find. AJ is looking at lion's feet, or at least at predator paws, and was wondering if you could explain a bit about dew claws and if what they get used for in lions, leopards, and so on and so forth. So AJ, the big cats do have them. In lions they're on the front, they're only on the front foot. In leopards they're only on the front foot. And they sit a little bit higher up on the paw and is the big cat's strongest claw. So for leopards and lions, that dew claw on the front foot, the equivalent of their thumbs, is immensely powerful and is generally the claw that is used when they're trying to catch prey. It's the claw that's actually really plays the biggest function in grasping on and holding on. And those claws are kept absolutely razor sharp. I've had a chance to have a look at a lion's dew claw before. They sit beautifully in the sheath, but a lion's dew claw is probably, when it's fully extended, about this long. So what's that, about 2.5 inches long and really, really strong. It's thick, thick, thick keratin. So that's the dew claw on a lion. Wild dogs don't have dew claws. They no longer serve any purpose. So the wild dogs do not have a dew claw sitting on their feet. It is what one of the many things that distinguishes them from our domestic dogs and from other species of dogs, canids. They don't have any dew claws, and it's basically just evolution has decided they don't need them. They hunt in a very different way to the big cats, and because they're pack hunters that tend to catch smaller prey than the lions, they no longer need them. A different adaptation. I'm trying to think about hyena front feet. I think hyena do have dew claws. Suddenly realized you found a hole, AJ, in my poor knowledge, my anatomy knowledge. Do hyenas have dew claws? I think they do. I'm relatively certain they do, but only on the front foot, like our big cats. It is very, very quiet out here. We have one hornbill. That is the heartbeat on Cheetah Plains for the moment. And even he's playing a little bit camera shy. Nice, gives us a chance to just stop and listen. Whoa. That wasn't very graceful, hornbill. And off he goes. Gives us a nice opportunity to stop and listen to the complete silence that is surrounding us. Onto a different tack entirely in terms of feet structure. Brenda in Canada. Not to talk about the hornbills, although actually funnily enough, the hornbill and the question that you've asked about, the answer is linked. Now, Brenda's been watching oxpeckers sit on buffalo and would like to know how it is they manage to grasp and hold on and not fall off. So they've got very, very special, specially adapted toes, quite similar to that of a hornbill. Now, a hornbill's got, I think a correct term is zygodactyl toes. So three in the front and one behind, as most passerines do, but a slight modification in that the two outside toes are semi-joined together. Now, an oxpecker has a slightly different approach in that they can have two toes facing forward and two toes facing backwards, and that helps to support them when they're on an almost horizontal surface. And then, in addition to that, the tail feathers of an oxpecker are reinforced to become really, really stiff and solid. So that means that they can actually almost lean back against their tails and then grasp on with their claws. They barely have to concentrate on moving their toes around. They barely have to concentrate on gripping. Their claws just sort of sink into the fur of the animal that they're sitting on. Different bird entirely. Don't fly over. Stop. You're going to disappear? Oh. That's not your fault, Dave. She's flying over our head. It was a female battalier. Well, it seems as though James is having more luck in terms of mammal life. He's found a kudu. Oh, Joey! Joey, I'm sorry. I completely forgot to answer your question earlier, but we'll pass it on to James. Maybe he can give you a better sense of scale with the kudu that he's found.
There is a kudu, everybody, and I know that many of you have been asking about whether or not animals out here get thick fur in the wintertime. That kudu has unquestionably got thicker fur than she did in the summer, and that's not because I recognize her by sight, but her fur is definitely much thicker. She was a bit closer when we found her, so unfortunately you can't really see it, but she has absolutely got much thicker winter fur. Now, there are a whole lot of kudu here, and you can hear the grey go-away birds going wah, wah. And the kudu are not alone. They're being accompanied by one lone impala ram. There he is over there. and he's hanging with the kudu for security. Now, Joey, in Australia, you're wondering about what the size comparison between a kudu and an impala is. Well, an impala weighs about 70 kilograms, that big one there, about the same as me, I suppose, plus minus. A kudu, much bigger. A kudu female sitting at around 120 to 140 kilograms, so double the size. And there's a young kudu, which is about the same size as an impala. Just knocking about through there. And the impala, absolutely certainly sitting with these kudus. A, because he's now browsing, there's no grass to eat, and B, because of the extra security provided by the kudus. See if we can get one more view of them. I'll also try and find another nice bird for VM to film, because he loves filming birds with this camera. Don't you, VM? Yes, the best fun in the world ever. There, you can maybe see a little bit there of how fluffy that kudu's fur is. Just a little bit longer and slightly less shiny than it would be in the summertime. Can you hear the birds? The oxpeckers there going off. But the Gurry Go Away birds are shouting very vociferously, and I don't know why. I think there is an element of alarm calling in it sometimes. Ooh. A red-billed woodhoopoe, well, now called the green woodhoopoe by the idiot ornithologists. Why is it called a green woodhoopoe, you may well ask? The answer is, I couldn't begin to tell you why you would call an animal with a bright red beak and a blue back a green woodhoopoe. Who knows? I think they've got a little nest in there. They're also communal nest breeders. Remember we had those white-crested helmet shrikes earlier on? They too live in a flock like that. They might just be looking for grubs in there. They've got those long, probing red beaks, looking for beetles and beetle larvae. They might have a nice warm hidey hole in that tree. Certainly if I was a green woodhoopoe at this time of the year, I would want to have a nice warm hidey hole to go and sit in. Wouldn't you, Vian? Mm-hmm. Well, the heater, you've had enough of these ones, have you?
Yes, a nice lounge.
Yes, a nice lounge. All right, on we go. We went past the Gallagher waterhole, there wasn't anything there. We went past the Juma Dam cam, there wasn't anything there. So those lions, I think, have gone east, as Aubrey said they had. Maybe we'll find them this afternoon. Maybe we'll just find more elephants. And I'm very happy to find elephants in the afternoon. They're always doing something. Lions in the afternoon, well, except for yesterday, of course, tend to be doing not very much at all. Fox hat, you're either taking the mickey or you're giving me far vastly too much credit for what you think I know. You say, what is the unladen airspeed of a swallow? I couldn't begin to tell you what the unladen airspeed of a swallow is. I know many swifts can fly at up to 120 kilometers per hour. That's when they're diving around. I'm imagining that a swallow can probably do, I don't know, I'm going to say probably up to 80 or 90 kilometers per hour. 80 or 90 kilometers an hour, so about 50 miles per hour. At maximum tilt. Remember, they don't fly in a straight direction for very long. And I wonder, you know, I'm pretty sure somebody would have measured it, somebody would have tried to measure it, especially on those migrating swallows that go off towards Europe, northern Europe and that sort of thing during the winter, our winter and your summer. But fox hat, that's a nice question that I'm afraid I'm unable to give you a definitive answer to. Sorry about that. It's obviously very difficult to measure a bird's speed. The humble dove, there is a humble dove. See how humble it is, Vim? It's on the ground there. Don't pretend. That humble dove, everybody, I've clocked one of them flying next to the car at about 70 kilometers per hour. That's straight line speed. Now, that's quite an achievement. And the reason they can fly that speed, is, of course, is because when the Falklands dive down on them, they come from about 200 kilometers an hour, and so that bird, despite being just a humble dove, has got to be able to explode off the ground and then fly off at a great speed. All right, everybody, that's going to be it from us today. Thank you, VM, for your efforts, and thank you to all of you for talking us for the course of this morning safari. To those of you in America, happy 4th of July, and we'll see you for our Ranger race competition this afternoon at about 3 o'clock. Until then, I'll hand you back to Jamie. Bye-bye. That is a very bright sun. Ugh.
And I echo James's sentiments in telling you a very happy 4th of July, and I hope you're looking forward to our special afternoon. Let's see if we can't get these on camera before the end of the sunrise safari. Oh, no, don't do that. We've got some woodhoopoos, just like James. Ah, oh, bye-bye woodhoopoos. Like the ones James had, but making a terrible racket and doing their backwards and forwards rocking call. Can still hear them. There they are, hidden away behind the leaves. Here's the rocking motion. Hello, mimicry. Once one starts calling, the others can't resist but to respond. I've always known them as red-billed woodhoopoos. They are, in fact, now known as green woodhoopoos. So a nice way to end off our sunrise safari. And it does give us an excuse to stop before we go through the massive signal dip that is the Mulwanini. Let's carry on. See if we can't find you anything for the last few moments before Dave and myself return to Juma for breakfast. We're both very much hoping it's a cooked breakfast, possibly pancakes, although I might be getting my hopes up tremendously just because I'm starving. I think it might be a fruit breakfast this morning, Dave. Yeah, no. Terribly sad. We are very spoiled when it comes to our provisions. Amanda looks after us beautifully in terms of meal times, which is why there's always an eager anticipation whenever we return back to camp after a long drive. And especially this morning, a very chilly drive. I'm glad that things have warmed up. In fact, it is actually time to probably remove my hot water bottle from beneath my jacket. Pop it there. No, this afternoon we've got plenty planned for the sunset safari. Don't forget about the Ranger race and the very special 4th of July fireside chat that I'm sure we're all looking forward to immensely. We'll just have to wait a couple of hours before we see you once again on the sunset safari. I haven't yet decided what I'm going to do or where I'm going to go. We'll figure that out when we get a bit closer to the time. Wonderful company out on drive, as well as to Lou and Chelsea in final control. And then, as always, most importantly, a big thank you to all of you watching across the world. It's fantastic to have you on board. It's like having you all on the back of the vehicle with us. Have a wonderful day. We'll catch you in a few hours. Bye-bye, everybody.